In many houses of worship, the minister, preacher, priest reads from a particular book again and again and again. And in fact, the entire liturgical year is built upon the readings of the book. This book before me is called the New Oxford Annotated Bible. It contains the Jewish scriptures and the Hebrew scriptures and the Christian scriptures. It is arranged in a particular format, which differs from other arrangements, so that it generally ends with the prophets leading up to the Christian scriptures. Those who study or read the Bible from cover to cover then have a sense of fulfillment. They have read prophecies, and lo and behold, you turn the page, and now the prophecies begin to be fulfilled. Now, having been raised in the tradition, which I was, Roman Catholic, we did not rely so much on Bible study. What we knew of the Bible, generally, we learned from the priest in the pulpit. I was one of those who was eager to read, and so I began to read the Bible privately, not studying, but just reading. And I was alarmed by some of the things I found herein. It seemed to contradict what I was being taught at church. One of the first things which changed my life is in the Gospel of Mark. Mark chapter 6. He went away from there and came to his own country, and his disciples followed after him. And on the Sabbath he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astonished, saying, "Where did this man get all of this? What is the wisdom given to him? What mighty works are wrought by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary and brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon, and are not his sisters here with us?" I read that, and I must have done a double take, and I probably gasped, because here it clearly says that Jesus had brothers and sisters, and it names the brothers. This completely, utterly contradicted what I had been taught as a Catholic. And when I read this passage, my life changed. It began a mission to study, not just to read, but to begin to study the scriptures. And that mission led me eventually to Meadville Lombard, where happily the motto is, "Search the scriptures." By the time I graduated from Meadville Lombard, I had a notebook with scriptures from the Hebrew and Christian scriptures proving beyond reasonable doubt that Jesus never thought he was God, that there was no Trinity, and that many beliefs which I had been raised to believe were flatly wrong. I would have benefited from the errancy encyclopedias, because in essence, I was beginning to rewrite them. It took a while for me to approach this book and these scriptures, Hebrew and Christian, and to find something of value and beauty in them. As I say, it was a watershed moment, and it launched my rebellion, launched my heresy. Heresy, as you may recall, means to choose, to read and to choose what is of value. And so everyone who reads the Bible and emphasizes certain scriptures over another is, in essence, a heretic. And so I stand before you a heretic. In my years at Meadville, I began to look back on the books that I had read. I began to search for the books I'd read as a child to look for episodes of racism and classism and sexism, to come to terms with what had been instilled in me by myself. And then I had to turn the same process to these scriptures before me. I was aware of how many, many books had influenced my life, how many writers. There was the poetry of William Butler Yeats, Sartre's No Exit, Camus' Myth of Sisyphus, the poetry of Winfield Owen, Hermann Hesse's Siddhartha, the most difficult book I ever read in my life, the writings of Bertrand Russell, in particular, Why I'm Not a Christian, Erasmus of Rotterdam, Voltaire, Thomas Paine, Abraham Lincoln, Thomas Dewey's A Simple Faith, the prose of William Ellery Channing, the prose of Ralph Waldo Emerson, Carl Sagan, Emily Dickinson, so forth and so on, Martin Luther King, and Joseph Campbell's Hero of a Thousand Faces. Each one of these represented a milestone in my religious journey, a new understanding and a change in direction in my thinking. And yet, they led me back to look at this book and to re-examine it and to weigh once again the various passages and to see what is of value, what continues to inspire me. There is much here that is truthful, much that is beautiful. It may not be true, literally speaking, but it is a book, a collection, a library that has just beautiful poetry. We read Ecclesiastes. That's actually my favorite passage from the Bible. Ecclesiastes, how many of you remember what Ecclesiastes means? Well, the PK, of course. It means the preacher. It's actually a rather dark, dark scripture. But that sense of balance that you find in Ecclesiastes is powerful. To everything there is a season. I read this particular scripture at each and every memorial service because it helps me focus, and I believe it helps every family focus, what does life mean? It is a journey. It is a journey of balance. Psalms. I hated the Psalms as a kid. I wonder what they would have sounded like if they were sung as they were originally intended to. I have revisited the Psalms, and I find that some are actually quite moving, some intellectually moving. My favorite psalm happens to be number 82. It is written, God has taken his place, we'll forgive the patriarchal and masculine language, God has taken his place in the divine council. In the midst of the gods, he holds judgment. He asks, how long will you judge unjustly and show partiality to the wicked? Give justice to the weak and the fatherless. Maintain the right of the afflicted and the destitute. Rescue the weak and the needy. Deliver them from the hand of the wicked. They have neither knowledge nor understanding. They walk about in darkness. He's referring to humanity. All the foundations of the earth are shaken. And so I say unto you, you are gods, sons of the Most High, all of you. Nevertheless, you shall die like the men do and fall like any prince. That was an amazing psalm. It's polytheistic. Who knew that the ancient Hebrews were polytheistic? But yet, there it is. And actually, my professors at the Divinity School insisted this is the oldest part of the Bible, but it's tucked away into the Psalms. Imagine what would happen if you opened the book of Genesis in the beginning and you read this. How might our understanding of Scripture have changed instead of being tucked away the 82nd Psalm? Everything in here, by the way, was arranged by person or persons unknown. And there are, of course, as I said to the children, many different translations, some which are prized by different religious groups, others which are abhorred. One of my favorite comments about the Bible was something I heard in high school. And there was a Florida state legislator who was discussing the issue of bilingualism in his state. And he was proposing that we should only have English, never mind these other foreign languages. And his argument was, if English was good enough for Jesus Christ, it should be good enough for us. That particular psalm that I read, I want to lift up something else in it. It is a call for social justice, a consciousness to those who are unfortunate. That is part of the beauty of the more powerful scriptures in this collection. It's not just intellectual, but it's a call to do something. I know that when I was younger, I was satisfied just to read and to be inspired, to let this ferment within, and perhaps to let it change my thinking. But there's something much more to the greater passages in the Bible, a call to action, a call to social justice. And it's that Bible which inspired people like Martin Luther King, a call to justice. And it's because, I think, because of Dr. King that I was compelled to go back and visit this collection. What shall we say of this Bible? There's a passage here, Micah 6. For what does the Lord God require of thee, but to love justice, to practice mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God? I found that one of the loveliest and most succinct passages in the Bible as far as what are we called to do, we human beings, during our brief lifetime. To love justice, to practice mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God. Mind you, I read this at a time when I was wrestling with a lot of creeds, wondering about the role of ritual and liturgy. What does it mean to be a religious person? To recite the proper prayers, to sing the proper songs, to write the candles a certain way, to light the candles a certain way, to receive communion? Some scriptures would say no. It can be summed up in three things. Again, to love justice. Why? Because justice is holy. To practice mercy. Why? Because religion should be relational. And we should be mindful of the fact that we are less than perfect. And to walk humbly with thy God. Not to walk humbly with the God, but the God of our understanding. It's a powerful, powerful statement in Scripture. And it reminds me of the passages attributed to Jesus. When the young man or the lawyer, depending upon which scripture you're reading, asks of him, "So what must I do to be saved?" "Well, it's very simple," he said. "You must love God with all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus says, "This is the whole, or the most important rule of Scripture." That's a very, very simple understanding, but it's a very poignant understanding. What must we do to be saved? Now, the people asking the question perhaps were thinking of eternal salvation, something in an afterworld. Jesus doesn't necessarily say there is an afterworld, but he says if you're going to have saved, if you're going to be redeemed, and as I and others have interpreted that, it's to be redeemed in this lifetime. You must first be moved by love, to love that which is holy, and to love your neighbor as yourself. I'm told that Abraham Lincoln believed that that was the most important passage of Scripture himself. I'm told that before Jesus, the Rabbi Hillel used that exact summation. A person had come up to the Rabbi Hillel and asked, "Can you describe the Torah or the teachings while you stand on one foot?" And the rabbi said, "Nothing could be easier." And so he stood on one foot and said, "Love God with all of your heart and love your neighbor as yourself." Everything else that is written here is commentary. The reason why this congregation was named after Abraham Lincoln is very simple. It was named after Abraham Lincoln because he said that he would join a church. Mind you, he never joined a church. but he declared he would join the church that would inscribe above its altar that simple commandment. No creed, but the whole or the sole measure of membership could be summed up in, you must love God with all of your heart, all of your mind, all of your soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. Unfortunately, in his time, such a church did not exist. But the people who framed this congregation felt that they were bringing together a group of people who were going to live that scriptural message. Very simple membership. All you have to do is love that which is holy and love your neighbor as yourself. If you can do that, you can be one of us. Now, you see it's not inscribed up above here, and I don't think it was inscribed over the other two houses of worship. But that was the spirit with which this congregation was founded 60, almost 61 years ago. It's powerful, powerful stuff. What are we to do with this Bible? You may recall that about a year ago, I gave a talk on the Bible scriptures, and I focused on the negatives. I focused on all the errors of scripture, all the bad advice, all the things which are actually harmful. I lifted up those particular passages, and a person got up, walked out, and resigned his membership. He was that offended. It's an amazing collection. It's not something to be delved into lightly. It is something rather to be studied. Studied with the great companions, as Walt Whitman called them. People who have done the work, have read it in its different languages, its original languages, and can connect not just the written page, but the oral tradition, the thousands of years of oral tradition that were told around campfires in the synagogues before they were ever written down. Now, of course, those written stories, many of them have been lost. We can only surmise based upon tantalizing clues of what is actually written down. But we have been able to discern that there were multiple authors of this book. And that's a very important distinction in this religious movement. We believe that this is a book of humankind, that men and women wrote this scripture. Men and women collected it in certain ways. We are aware that there are many translations. We are aware that there are many different ways to arrange the text material. Did you know that there is a Protestant version of the Bible as well as a Catholic version? And they include different books, and the order, sequence of these books is arranged very differently. Did you know that in these collections, there's often duplicate stories? Have you ever noticed how much repetition there is in Scripture? Raise your hand if you've noticed this before. Have you ever asked yourself why there is so much repetition? Raise your hand. How many of you have found out the answer? Well, different authors. In Genesis, there are two creation stories. There are actually two other creation stories buried elsewhere in the book of Job and the Psalms. But if you just look at the book of Genesis, which is my favorite book overall, because it comes first, and I probably read it more times than any other part of the Bible, there are two creation stories. And the first creation story is taken from the northern kingdom of Israel, where God is referred to as El or Elohim. Literally, Elohim means the gods. And in that creation story, male and female are created simultaneously. Turn to the next chapter, and the events of creation take place again from the beginning. But if you were to actually write down in two columns the sequence of events, you would begin to notice that the sequence of events are very different. Likewise, if you turn to the Christian scriptures and write down the genealogy of Yashu or Jesus, they're different. They're told several places. Why is that? Well, we can go to the books of biblical errancy and just say, well, they're wrong, and that's all we need to know. Or we could begin to study more about the different kingdoms and sources of Scripture, the northern kingdom versus the southern kingdom of Judah. Whenever the writer came from the southern kingdom, he refers to God as Yahweh. And so Yahweh is a personification writ large. This is the God who takes human form, who walks with Adam and Eve in the garden. And actually, one good author, Harold Bloom, went through the Bible and he extracted all the scriptures that you can attribute to the king, to the writer from the kingdom of Judah, where God is anthropomorphic. And he calls it the Book of J. And so this is one slice of the Bible, of the Hebrew scriptures, all from that one source. And it's a charming collection, but it's only a fragment. If I was going to go through the Bible, I would probably, well, I would certainly prefer the writings of the Northern Kingdom, the priestly version in particular. It's much better poetry. To turn again, though, to my favorite parts. I should have prefaced by saying, when I was a kid, I used to engage in dueling Bibles. Any of you ever do that? You meet some kid from another household who follows another religion, and you point to passages that prove that you're right and he's going to hell. Any of you ever do that? It was one of my favorite games as a child. One of the things which is especially important to our tradition, to the Unitarian Universalists of the first and second generation, was the Epistle of James. This James is the same James mentioned in Mark as the brother of Jesus. And if you study the history of the early church, after Jesus is crucified, James takes over the leadership of the church. And his vision of what was supposed to happen with Christianity after the death of Jesus, it is very, very powerful, and it aligned itself very strongly with the early Unitarians of Boston. And in James 1, he writes, "Be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who observes his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself and goes away and at once forget what he was like. But he who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and perseveres, being no hearer that forgets, but a doer that acts, he shall be blessed in his doing. If any one of you thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his heart, this man's religion is vain. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their affliction, and to keep oneself unstained from the world." Later on, and he says, "But some will say, quote, 'You have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I by my works will show you my faith.'" That comes very close to what we say, that we believe in deeds, not creeds. And the early followers of Unitarianism in this continent paid especial attention to the writings of James. Now, you may have heard that Unitarians are the Protestants' Protestants. These are people who are prone to disagreement and argumentation. This might be one reason why I was called to the pulpit. But we also believe that you speak your faith through your works. And if you remember, this is also very close to what the Dalai Lama was teaching. If you have a faith, if you have true religion, we will discover it, not in what you say you believe or not in what you say you don't believe, but in how you live your life. And that is really the central scripture of Unitarian Universalism as preached today. You can find this sentiment in many scriptures the world over, but that is at heart the sentiment and the scripture that breathes through the centuries through this liberal religious tradition. To those who think that they are above Scripture, or that because it is flawed, it is something to be thrown away, I refer you again, as I did in my opening words, to Walt Whitman. The sum of all known reverence I add up in you, whoever you are. Those who govern are there for you. It is not you who are there for them. The sun and stars that float in the open sky, the apple-shaped earth and we upon it, the endless pride and outstretching of people, unspeakable joys and sorrow. It is for you, whoever you are. It is no farther from you than your hearing and sight are from you. It is hinted by nearest, by commonest, by readiest. Let us consider Bibles and religions divine. I do not say that they are not divine. I say that they have grown out of you and may grow out of you still. It is not they who give life. It is you who give life. Will you seek afar off? You surely come back at last in things best known to you, finding the best or as good as the best, and that is happiness and knowledge, not in another place, but this place, not for another hour, but this hour. So may it be.